Hello, my queens. This is The Sit Down, and I'm here with friend and playwright Jeremy O'Harris. You know him as the creator of Slave Play and the upcoming play Daddy, or as I call it, Zaddy. Zaddy on Broadway. Hi, sis. How are you?
Hi.
I'm so excited to do this.
I'm so excited, too.
Really funny.
I mean, it's easier to do something like this when it's, like, with someone you, like, have, like, sort of peripherally known for a long time. It's, like, nerve-wracking to do it otherwise.
Yeah, that's true. That's a good point. Well, let's get into it. Here's something you tweeted, and I saw someone like it this morning, and it was back on my timeline. You tweeted, y'all, the Daddy set is loaded, and I could cry. I walked up to the pool, which is on the stage, last night, and when I tell you that okay, girl, why are you using these big-ass words? Versimilitude is strong with this one. I'm not kidding. Okay, step one. I'm a poet. What the fuck is versimilitude? And why? Tell me about the emotions. How are you feeling?
I mean, I was texting my friend Misha Marin, who wrote a book recently called Sugar Run that got compared to Raymond Chandler, so buy it. But anyway, she was just saying, like, I feel crazy right now, like, everyone, and, like, I feel the same way, because it's, like, I don't feel like anything's changed, but, like, people come up to me on the train, and they're like, did you write Slave Play? And I'm like, that's weird.
Wow.
So, yeah, I feel even crazier doing this play, because this play is a play about a young artist who, like, becomes famous, and or like there's, like, he does a big art show and it, like, does really, really well, and there's so much meta things inside that it's, like, feels like, you know, like, as my mom would say, like, I prophesied some things about myself, you know, like, literally just lines are said, like, there's even, like, a line about Madonna in the play that's just, like,
my God.
So weird, because she came to, like, she saw one of the last performances of Slave Play, so sitting in the room, like, minding that play has been crazy. But the set for this play was something that I thought would never get realized, because it's supposed to be in the backyard of, like, a Bel Air mansion. And I walked backstage, like, I walked to the set the other day, and it was, you were truly, I'm gonna just show you a picture.
Yeah, please, okay, hold on, transport it.
Okay, no one else can see it, but he can.
I'm so excited.
I was showing
it, yeah, it's got, like, a big swimming pool. Okay, all right.
Yeah.
All right. That was...
Yeah.
That's literally the back of a mansion. Okay. Well, exciting. You described the play as a love letter to mamas and mama's boy, and I'm very much a mama's boy. How does that kind of relationship and dynamic manifest in the play?
Well, I mean, so the play, like, it's sort of I think that it's really important that people recognize that, like, the typography of Daddy is, like, a part of the, like, title.
Okay.
And Daddy on the page, it says Daddy in quotes.
It's okay.
Like, so it's like a spoken Daddy, or it's like an ironic Daddy.
Okay.
And I think, as someone who was raised by a single mother, like, you know, I've heard the phrase, like, I'm your mom and your dad, like, so many times in my life. So, like, one of the major functions inside of the play is that, like, you think you're watching this, like, thing that, like, is only a thing where Alan Cumming and Ronald Pete are, like, intersecting. But then Charlene Woodard shows up, and Charlene Woodard looks a lot like Ronald Pete.
So it's like, ooh.
Yeah, people can make their decisions about, like, who she is before they go see the show.
But, interesting. Yeah. Well, okay, of course, interracial relationships figure in Daddy, but are a huge part of every part of Slave Play, which I did see, you know, before it closed. I'm so glad I was able to see it. And for people who haven't seen it, I would just describe it as interracial couples use slave plantation cosplay as a form of sex therapy. And it is complicated as it sounds, full, you know, everything. So what I wanted to, there's so many questions I wanted to ask you, but first, you know, were you surprised by the response to the play? Because it was very intense, not just from people who saw the play, but from people, I think, who didn't see the play and just were, like, tweeting very angry about it.
Yeah. I mean, I think that, like, every response to the play was, like, overwhelming. I mean, like, having someone like Jesse Green, like, write some of the things he said about my play in the Times was, like just, like, really overwhelming and, like, sort of turned my head around, like, having Vincent Cunningham write what he wrote. And then having the internet, like, in the Twitter sphere, I have such, like, an adverse reaction, not only to, like, the ideas that, like, were around the play, but, like, also the title. I mean, the title in relationship to, like, the responses of people like The New Yorker or The New York Times, like, how all of that coalesced into, like, me becoming this, like, sort of monster of some fictive monster in the mind of some parts of Twitter. Was really, it was enough to send me to Tulum.
Really?
I went.
So it was difficult.
Yeah, it was really difficult. And I went to Tulum for, like, 2 weeks with some of my friends, and, like, I got, like, acupuncture and cupping, and, you know, I realigned, and, like, I realized that, like, that in a lot of ways, like, I'm a Gemini. Mm-hmm. So, one, like, I always am going to be someone who's going to invite more conversations.
Mm-hmm. That's a nice way to put it.
More conversations around anything I'm, like, engaging in than, like, not. Uh-huh. And so, like, that was a good, and that's a good thing. And also, like, people are talking about a play. Like, whether they're, like, talking about it in a way that's like, fuck,
You can curse. Oh, okay,
yeah,
girl.
Yeah, but it was like, there was a lot of like, fuck this nigga, like, he crazy, like, mm-hmm. what's wrong with him? Mm-hmm. Online, even if it's that, like, it's still someone saying something about an off-Broadway play in a 200-seat house, max, you know? And that is... That is something that, like, you can't buy that. You know what I mean? So you can't even predict that. And I think that what it means for me is that, like, I'm at least having people think about, like, what the impact of theater can be in a white institution. Because I think that was where a lot of the anxiety came from. And I think having these conversations are really great. And I just wish that there had been more of a chance for me to, like, articulate some of the things I wanted to do with the play to some of the people who, like, would never be able to see it. Because that's one of the limitations of the form I engage in. But also, like, I think that, like, it had to be this way.
It had to be this way.
Yeah.
Well, you tweeted something I thought was really interesting about phones, people on their phones in the play. And I saw the back and forth that was going on. You said this. I hate this so much when people complain about phones. If you truly think if your play or musical can't keep people off their phones, maybe the phone isn't the problem. I do not have nostalgia for a time when phones weren't in the theater. Can you imagine sitting through one-third of Miller? Without a play, my God. And I thought that was really interesting because often, I mean, you know, actors, like, I don't know, like Patti LuPone and, and I think Lin-Manuel Miranda will have moments where they have called people out while on stage, like, get off your phone. So how do you reconcile that?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, like, part of that, the energy around that is just the fact that, like, I'm more interested in, like, inviting new audiences to the theater than, like, pushing them out. And I think that, like, the reality of having, like, really strict phone policies is that, like, the people they're going to harm are going to be people that look like us. And we're the people I want to see in the theater. But, like, the people who generally engage with the most entitled behavior are generally are the ones who, like, don't have their phones turned off or rumble around with their phones during the play in, like, the rudest of ways are generally people who did not grow up as digital natives, you know? They're just, like, a nature of the thing. You know, digital natives know, like, oh, well, I should probably put my phone on silent, even though I am going to check it like this, you know? But it's always me who's the first person who, when I sit down and just have my phone and I'm putting it on airplane mode, some, like, white lady is like, excuse me, you know you should turn that all the way off. You know, which happened to my friend Amina Tao when she saw Slave Play. And so I think that, like, while I do recognize that, like, part of the contract of live performance is us, like, you know, being there with the actors and, like, staying focused, like, I think we also can't forget that, like, this is, in the Western tradition, disruption by audience is has been, like, a part of, like, has been, like, also a part of the contract. You know, like, whether
it's
it was,
call
like,
and response. Live theater.
Exactly. And, like, whether it was, like, in the 1800s and 1700s, like, you know, throwing fruit on stage during, like, the melodramas in France, or, like, people having, like, straight-out debates with the in the forms of the Greeks. Like, theater is a place where people can, like, broadcast their love, their distaste, their boredom, anything. And I think that a phone is just like a broadcasting of that.
It can be. And there's like one more thing. We, of course, you and I could talk like all day long. But I did want, and I know you've got to get back to rehearsals for Daddy.
We're right over there.
But I did want to ask you as well, I've been thinking about Jussie Smollett and being attacked, and understandably that hit everyone hard, anyone with compassion, but certainly queer black men, right? That this has been a hard experience watching someone we identify with hurt in this way. You are an artist who is increasingly public and, you know, does work that is about race and sex in a very direct way. So what is it like? I just wanted to ask you, you know, kind of thinking through this vulnerability on stage when it is very much an ongoing experience outside of the theater.
I think that, I mean, I have this whole, I feel like the thing that might, and again, like all things in politic, that there are politic, like there's no right answer, right? But my right answer for how to like keep my body safe is like not hiding parts of my identity from people. Like by being like, you know, I have never fetishized a queer experience that like need that, or a queer expression that like necessitates closets, you know? And so when I first started writing plays, I was always like, how do I write like the most, like, honest portrayals, mm-hmm. Or at least, like, psychologically honest portrayals mm. of, like, my Black queer objectivity and subjectivity, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. And I think what's been really cool about working on Slave Play, and, like, right before I worked on Daddy, is that, like, Slave Play is very much about how, like, the world makes objects of Black bodies mm. and how, like, we can either, like, embody the object they see for us or mutate the body that they're seeing mm-hmm. to, like,
reject that.
Yeah, to reject it, yes. And then in Daddy, which is a play I wrote before Slave Play, mm-hmm. it was, like, my very first play I wrote, mm-hmm. It's about, like, Black subjectivity mm. and how, like, a Black queer person might see the world, mm. you know, like, pure, like, the play is completely from Franklin's eyes. Mm. And thinking about how putting on stage that, like, perhaps there's, like, a Freudian nightmare happening inside of every sexual encounter with, like, any person you might engage with, like, I think is, like, a much more, like, is a way to, like, confront those who might hate me mm. or want to see me in a more direct manner, because I'm not saying, like, guys, like, don't, like, hate us. Like, we hold hands in public just like you guys, but, like, we keep what we do in the bedroom. It's like, no, I want you to know, like, in your bedroom what I do in mine. That way, like, like, the monsters you make of me, like, I can just put them in your room. You know what I mean? Before you can.
Wow.
So I think that, like, that's part of that's my response to, like, all of the hate people who, like, don't want to see our bodies mm-hmm. exist. Mm-hmm. It's like, if you don't want to see our bodies exist just like this, mm-hmm. I'm going to show my body existing in the way that, like, you fear it exists. Mm-hmm. And, like, maybe go beyond that fear.
I live, and that's why I love your work. Jeremy, I'm so happy for you.
Thank you.
Continue to thrive. Because, I'm getting my life from it. Guys, Daddy premieres February 12th at the Vineyard Theater in New York City. I'm going to go see it. Let's go see it together, children. All right, up next, Sylvia Obell. And I see you about to say something. Sylvia Obell and Essence are going to bring you some Black Girl magic.